Welcome. Today I'm going to be showing you guys how to play Carcassonne Safari. Now, I'm already under the assumption that most of you know how to play Carcassonne already. And if you don't know how to play Carcassonne, I suggest you watch my How to Play video for Carcassonne, or the many other How to Play videos of Carcassonne that are on. So, anyways, since that's the case, we're going to be just going over basically the rules for this particular Carcassonne Safari. Because Carcassonne Safari is very different from Carcassonne. In fact, there are a lot of Carcassonnes out there, but most of them, more or less, are very similar. And this one I have found is probably the most different by far. So let's go over how to play this game. Now, first of all, what I want to say is these elephant meeples are actually only for your scoreboard. So you just put your elephant meeples on the scoreboard here to keep track of your score. Another thing they did, which I really, really love, is a lot of the times, especially if you're playing a two-player game, a lot of the times you would score over 50 points. And then you would have to, like, somehow keep track of how many you have by maybe, you know, putting the meeple on its back or flipping it upside down or something like that in order to try to keep track. And that was always annoying because, you know, it's just annoying, right? Especially trying to do it upside down. Especially if you get over 100 points, it was really super annoying. And so they came up with these little tokens here that you'll actually take once you reach 50 points. And then you'll just resume course, of course, with your elephant. And then once you reach 100 points, you just flip this over, and now you've got 100 points plus whatever else you have with your meeple. And if you somehow were to get more, and you were playing a two-player game, you just grab another 50, for instance. So that's how you keep track of your score, a whole lot easier than it was originally with any other Carcassonne I've played. Of course, I have not played them all, so maybe there's other Carcassonnes out there that have done this, but I was really impressed that they did this to make it a whole lot easier. Now, that's all there is to really know about the scoreboard, with the exception of what's down here. So in Carcassonne, normally you would score points for tiles, for the amount of tiles that were part of your city or your road, etc., etc. In this Carcassonne, though, you do not score points for tiles. You could have 50 tiles that make up your bush, which is like this version of the city, basically, this game's version of the city, but it wouldn't matter. That 50 points would not count. Those 50 tiles would not count towards your score. So this is how the score actually works for the game. It actually works with the amount of animals you've got. And I say animals, I mean different animals. So, let's go over it, shall we? Oh, another thing to note is there are these jeeps here. Two white jeeps. And you get 3 points whenever you put down a tile where a jeep is sitting. So if a jeep was sitting here, and you were to put a tile here, you would automatically displace the jeep, earning yourself 3 extra points for the jeep. The jeep would go into your, like, personal inventory, if you will. And then if you decided not to place a meeple down on the tile you just placed, or a meeple down elsewhere, because there are exceptions to the putting a meeple down rule in this particular expansion, in this particular Carcassonne, you could then move the jeep to another location where you think you'll probably place a tile, so that way you can keep scoring 3 points whenever you place a tile. Of course, your opponent can do the same thing as well, and who knows, they might end up with both of your jeeps, both of the jeeps, depending on where you are able to place stuff. But that's still a pretty cool addition to the game, and definitely maybe a little bit more interactive as well. So that's pretty cool. All right, so let's go over one of the first tiles, the trail. So the trail is this game's version of the road. So we'll just put it here. Now, if this road was somehow complete, if this was a dead end at the end of the trail, I would score only 3 points
because I have a lion and I have a giraffe on this trail. So let's just put the meeple down here, because I just placed it, right? I put the meeple down. Let's just say it ended. This is obviously the wrong side of a tile that you would never use this side normally, but just as an illustration that this ended it. You would score this how many points. I have two different animals here. So that would score me 3 points. If I only had one different animal, meaning I could have 5 zebras, but I would only get 1 point because I only have one species of animal. So that's something to note. So if you want to get a huge amount of points, you of course want to try to get all 5 different animals. What are the different animals? Well, there's the chimpanzee, there's the giraffe, there's the elephant, there's a zebra, there's the lion, and the zebra is, well, it's somewhere. Ah, here. And here's the zebra, for instance. There's 2 of them there on this one. So those are the 5 animals that count towards this particular score here, which is pretty interesting, of course. So that's kind of cool. And then, so with that said, if this is all I had here, and that was the end of the trail, so to speak, there are ways of actually adding animals to the trail. So like during your turn, after you've placed your tile and your meeple, you could add an animal like this, for instance, this chimpanzee here. You could add it to the trail, and that would add an additional animal. And then instead of just getting 3 points, you would actually get 6 points, which is pretty nice. In the game, you actually start with 2 of these animals randomly. You don't get to pick. They're all face down. I just left them in my box so I wouldn't lose all of them. But, you know, we got 2 here, and that's what you would start with. You can get more of these throughout the game. There's a way of doing it, and we'll get to that towards the end of the how to play for this video. But the point is, you could use these towards that goal for the trail. That's one option that you could do with these tiles here. So that's pretty cool. So anyways, that's a pretty interesting thing. Cool. Now, we explained how the trail works and how you would get the amount of points you would need for to complete the trail. Let's talk about the bush next. So the bush is Safari's version of the city. So here we have a bush, and it looks like it's got a trail on it as well. So let's put the bush like right here as an illustration. Okay, so it doesn't complete the bush yet, right? But we've already got a lion in the bush. We also have 2 birds in the bush as well. Think of the birds as the coat of arms for the original Carcassonne, except the coat of arms would score you 2 points, and the birds, they only score you 1 point each. And on the plus side, there are more birds than there were coat of arms from the original Carcassonne. So in this version, if you were to get a bunch of forest pieces, like let's say, I don't like that one, because it doesn't give me, okay, here we go. Let's try this one. Okay, so let's say this was the next piece, and this ended the forest, and you had your meeple here on that piece in the bush. Okay? So, obviously, there's a lion and there's a chimpanzee. And those are the 2 of the 5 different animals that you would need. The birds don't count towards that. So you would get, once again, 3 points plus 2 points for the birds. So you would score 5 points for that forest. You wouldn't score any additional points for the amount of tiles it took to complete the bush, but you would get that many points, so 5. So obviously, you want to obviously try to get as many animals in the bush as possible. Maybe you would add, I don't know, a giraffe to the bushes, and that would make it obviously 3 different species, which would equal 6 points, plus 2 for the birds, which would be 8 points, obviously. But you obviously want to try to get as many of the species as you can in a forest, if possible, to complete it. And then, of course, once the bush was complete, just like in regular Carcassonne, you would get your meeple back. Now, that's how that works. So, obviously, you do score more points, usually, in the bush, because unlike the trail, the bush has those birds that add a few points to the equation depending on how many you have. And the trail has no birds on it. So obviously you're still going to score more points with the bush than you would a road, or should I say the trail. But once again, they're about almost as hard to complete sometimes as the cities once were. So that's how that works. Now, what else is in this game? Well, if you've played the original Carcassonne, you might remember the monastery. The Boabab tree is actually this game's version of the monastery. So I'm going to put that there. So here's the Boabab tree. You can put a meeple down, or like this maybe even, on the Boabab tree like that. And it would be almost similar to the monastery. But unlike the monastery, you do not score any points with the Boabab tree. You do have to complete all of the tiles around the Boabab tree, but you do not get any points for it. Instead, when you place the meeple down on the Boabab tree, you get two more animals. And I just randomly grabbed these. So you'd get two more for placing the meeple down on the Boabab tree. Then, once the tiles went all the way around the Boabab tree, you would get two more of these animals. And that's how you're going to get all of these animal tokens. That's the only way you're going to do it. And then, of course, once you surrounded the Boabab tree with tiles all the way around, you would get your meeple back, like normal, with the original Carcassonne. So that's how that works. And that's pretty fascinating. Pretty interesting, of course. Now, what else can you do with this game? Well, the animal tokens have another function as well. You can also, you can also use them as a watering hole. You can dig a watering hole in a section of the savanna that has no bush nearby. Now, this is far enough away. The bush is far enough away over here and over here. But you need a nice corner of just savanna to build, or should I say dig, a watering hole. And so if you were to decide after placing a tile, and the tile could be over here, for instance. You could place a tile all the way over there, and you could decide instead of placing a meeple down or moving the Jeep around, you could instead, for instance, put this tile, this little animal token down, which is a watering hole, over on this corner instead, or that corner, or that corner, or that corner instead, even though it's not touching that tile there, and place a meeple on it. That's how that works. So what do you score for doing that? Well, you score 3 points. You place a meeple down, you score 3 points for the first section of the watering hole. Now, the next time you were to place a meeple down, it would, the next time you add on to the watering hole to make it bigger, let's say that was the next one, you couldn't do this one though, because as you see, we have two elephants here on this watering hole. You're only allowed to put one down. If you're the same player that put this down, you wouldn't be able to do an elephant. However, if your opponent wanted to dig a watering hole where you're digging a watering hole to make it bigger, they could put it like that, which is still technically not really attached yet, just like in the regular Carcassonne with normal tile placement rules. You could place it down like that. You could have your meeple down here, and your opponent could have their meeple down, obviously, on this one. And it wouldn't matter if it was the same animal or not, because they're basically sort of started their own watering hole, even though it will connect at some point. So that's pretty interesting. And then, since you scored the first section of the watering hole, you get 3 points. But since they scored the second one, they would get 4 points. And then whoever put down the next watering hole piece, they would get 5 points. Whoever put down the last watering hole piece would get 6 points. And if you did have two meeples here of two different colors, then they would all share 3 points extra for completing the water hole. But if only one player actually had, completed it, by having an elephant, for instance, a chimpanzee, for instance, a lion, for instance, and a giraffe, for instance, to complete it. And you could also use a zebra, obviously. But since there's only five and only four needed, that would be the case. You would complete this nice little watering hole, which obviously isn't quite looking as pretty as it could be. But you would complete it, and only you would score the 3 points. And then you would, of course, get your meeple back. But if you were sharing it, you would both get the 3 points and both get your meeples back. So that's how the watering hole works. So that's pretty fascinating. Now, after the game is over, the end game score goes on. Now, for all players who haven't finished a bush, and they have a meeple in a bush, and they weren't able to complete the bush, like, let's say I had a bush here, and I wasn't able to complete it yet, and let's see here. Let's find a piece that doesn't finish it up quite yet, but gives me something interesting. Hold on. Oh, here we go. And let's see. Oh, here. Better yet, this one. Okay, let's say this was the point. Let's say I had a meeple here in this particular bush here. I had two lions and I had three birds. Well, the difference in end scoring for a bush is a little different from normal. Because normally, you wouldn't get an additional point for having two of the same animal, like this lion here, for instance. But the end game scoring is, you actually get 1 point for every animal that is in the bush, not every different animal. So you would get 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 points for the bush instead of getting, well, 1, 2, 3, 4 points. So that's how that would work. But because you're only getting 1 point for each animal, you're not going to be scoring with these. So you're not going to be able to, unfortunately, get a huge high number for scoring a bush at the end of the game when the bush isn't completed. Same thing with the trail. You're only going to get 1 point for every animal in the trail. No points are awarded for meeples that are still on a baobab tree. You will not get points for a baobab tree. You will also not get points for an incomplete watering hole as well. Sad to say, but you will get points for every one of these animal tokens that are still sitting on the table here that haven't been used yet. You'll get one more additional point for each of them as well. And that is the end scoring for the game. And that's how it would work. So that's pretty much it. That is pretty much all the big, huge differences in scoring, etc., etc., for this particular Carcassonne. So obviously, animals play a huge role in this expansion, in this standalone Safari Carcassonne game, which is why I like it so much. It is so unique in comparison to a lot of the other Carcassonnes. Even Carcassonne Amazonas isn't quite as interesting as this. Even though you still technically score points for the animals in that one, you don't get animal tokens for Amazonas. So that's really, really cool. I really love this expansion a lot. And thank you guys for watching How to Play Carcassonne Safari. See you guys again soon.